We are on another session of our study circle. It's an interesting topic to be considered today. I'm happy that G. Ashwapathy has taken up this initiative of carrying over this session with this topic on the arbitration law. As you all know, Ashwapathy is a practicing lawyer. He had been an arbitrator in many cases. He is one of the founders of the Cinica, and he has been doing a lot of arbitration matters and a forerunner as far as the arbitration law is concerned. So, but he gives us some insights on the today's topic. I welcome Ashwapathy, and the floor is with him now.
Thank you, Om, for
just a moment. Yeah. 1 second, Ashwa.
Fine.
Okay, friends, please go on the mute mode before he starts the lecture. Thank you.
Yeah, the muting is important. We don't want to be a part of your family feud, any shouting from your house. We know that. We also have it, but we don't want to hear that. Okay. Thanks, Arnold, for allowing me to be present here. Siva, can I share my screen now? Siva, can you confirm that my screen is there?
Yes, it is coming.
Okay.
One second. I don't know whose mic it is. I can hear some kid crying. And they go in mode mute.
When somebody joins the fresh, that issue happens.
They have to put it in mute mode.
Yeah.
I will again inform them. Friends, kindly have yourself in mute mode.
Mic is on, Galaxy 7 is on.
Just a moment.
Only those two mics are on, Achyudanandan and Galaxy J7. Yes, okay, that is also muted.
I think Achyudanandan
Galaxy J7. Fine, you can go ahead.
Okay, friends, today we are going to consider the topic on independence and impartiality in arbitration. So, with respect to any adjudication process, especially in quasi-judicial process, the important aspect is independence and impartiality of the person who is to adjudicate the dispute. In arbitration, I would say it is the spine of the entire arbitration process. Without the confidence of the arbitrator, the arbitration proceedings would not be complete in a proper manner. Independence by itself would mean, with respect to arbitration and adjudication, it shall mean that the arbitrator shall not be have any personal interest in the dispute before him. He will have a free will to decide the disputes.
Very good.
Similarly, with respect to impartiality, the meaning would be that the arbitrator shall treat the parties alike and be unbiased and give equal opportunity and fair and just opportunity to all. Now, this independence and impartiality can be considered under the Arbitration Act 1996 as two different periods. One is before the Amendment Act 2015 and one after the Amendment Act 2015. Before the Amendment Act, how the provisions were and where it was dealt with, let's first see that aspect. It was considered under Section 11A, where the court was required to secure the independence and impartiality of the arbitrator whom it is going to appoint. In other words, the court was also to consider the person is want to be an independent and impartial person before appointing him as the arbitrator. Next, apart from this, this provision has been dealt with in Section 12 and 13. This is with respect to the arbitration provisions. I'm now going into the conciliation provisions. So we are sticking to arbitration proceedings. These are the sections which were dealing with independence and impartiality. Now, what happens under Section 12? What was it required under Section 12? If you see that, it was a mandatory provision. I'll come again. The section with respect to 12 was a mandatory provision whereby the arbitrator was required to give a disclosure in writing prior to his appointment. That is when a request has been made, and when he accepts his appointment, at that point of time, he has to give an disclosure in writing, giving the circumstances which gives rise to a justifiable doubts as to his independence and impartiality. Now, during the course of arbitration, if the arbitrator comes to know about certain circumstances that arises, then he would again bring out those disclosure and provide the same to the parties to the dispute. This disclosure should be done without any delay, and this is a mandatory form, and there is no waiver of this. Now, when a disclosure is given and thereafter an arbitrator appointment is going to be challenged, it can be challenged only on two grounds, which we find in Section 13. One is on the ground of justifiable doubts as to the independence and impartiality of the arbitrator. And the other one is if the parties find that the arbitrator's qualification is not in accordance with what they had agreed upon. The parties are always at liberty to agree on certain qualifications that the arbitrator has to possess. And if they find at a later point of time that the arbitrator does not possess that quality or that qualification, sorry, it's not quality, it's qualification, then they can always approach him to challenge his appointment. Now, the procedure for challenge was also given under Section 13 as to how the appointment has to be challenged. The parties, as in most of the sections in arbitration, were given a liberty to agree on a particular procedure under which they can challenge. This was giving the party autonomy, and they have to challenge it within 15 days of them coming to know about the constitution of the tribunal or on the coming of to aware of the circumstances which arises for a doubt with respect to the independence and impartiality. Once this objection is raised, the arbitrator is got an option of either withdrawing. Of course, his withdrawal doesn't mean that he is accepting to it, which has been provided for under Section 15. It only means that he wants to withdraw and he wants the office to continue by some other arbitrator. Similarly, if the arbitrator does not want to withdraw, but he finds that there is no circumstances that exist, then he can continue with the procedure. Here, what happens is in the deprived party can take up this issue only at the time of challenging the award under 34. I will come to it in a couple of slides later as to how and why this provision is framed it in this manner. Rather, I will say that in this particular slide. Now, so far as the old act is concerned, or the prior to the amendment is concerned, these are the points that we have to consider. First and foremost, the party autonomy, such as any party, any person can be appointed as an arbitrator, and the parties can agree on the procedure to appoint the arbitrator. So the party's autonomy is given utmost importance. Next is, the arbitrator has to disclose the circumstances which may affect his independence or impartiality before the appointment and or as and when it arises. Now, here we need to understand one aspect. It is the arbitrator's duty to come and disclose the circumstances, what are all that are available to him. Whatever he feels that those are circumstances he has to come and give. It is not available that there are certain specific grounds under which the disclosure has to be given, and that has to be provided by the arbitrator. It was simpliciter mentioned that whatever the arbitrator finds that would affect his independence or impartiality, he should give a disclosure. So in other words, the term was very wide and every other aspect could be brought into this aspect. The next important aspect is, well, challenging the grounds for on justifiable doubts, we saw earlier, it has to be made under Section 13. And in case of an unsuccessful challenge, it can be raised under 34. The important point here to be noted is, bias is the important aspect which, when it comes to the independence and impartiality. Bias, I would always say, does not have its own legs. It has to be established by way of an award. So a person, if is an arbitrator, if we find him as biased, we bring it to him and he says, no, I'm not biased, I still proceed with the arbitration, that bias will ultimately come up in an award. Until that award comes in, we will not have a conclusive proof that the person or the arbitrator is under bias. Supposing we'll take an example, like the claimant finds that the arbitrator is biased towards the respondent, and the claimant challenges the arbitrator's appointment, saying that he is biased and he has found some circumstances that exist which is affecting the independence or impartiality of the arbitrator. The arbitrator goes to the challenge and finds that there is no such circumstance exists, and he closes down the challenge. Now, ultimately, the arbitrator allows the claim. Now, what happens to the suspicion of the claimant? It goes with the claim award. So that's what is important. What is important here is a claim for independence or impartiality of an arbitrator is only based on a presumption, and it is not a conclusion by itself. This preposition of law was well admitted at the time of the Act of 1996, which came into force, that is prior to 2015. Similarly, one more interesting aspect would be, the section would state that in case the challenge is unsuccessful, it has to be taken under 34. If you see Section 34, interestingly, there will be only two components to it. One is where the parties have to prove from the record that certain events have occurred which amount to an act where the award has to be set aside, or when the court comes to know that it has to be set aside. In all the grounds that has been mentioned under 34, one would not find a ground where it says the arbitrator was not able to perform his duties with freedom or with independence or impartiality. There is no such ground. I was asking myself a question as to why that provision has been made in such a manner, though in the Section 13 it says it reflects to 34, whereas in 34 there is no specific ground that can be raised for the same. Only answer that I could find is, it amounts only to the public policy aspect. So which the court has to come to its conclusion that there is a bias, and that would affect the conscience of the person who is reading it, and hence it comes under the public policy. So therefore, the bias was always treated as an aspect of a suspicion rather than a conclusion. This is the entire principle under which the 1996 Act came into. Now we will go to the next aspect. When the situation was this, there were a lot of judgments which were coming where appointments of arbitrators were upheld, even though they were the employees of the institutions, especially in government contracts. Based on this, various other factors also, the Law Commission report of 246, headed by Justice A.P. Shah, had given a report. This had come somewhere in August 2014. With respect to neutrality, it said that the independence and impartiality is a critical process, and it is to be established well in the Act. And it also said that the Act does not lay down the circumstances that arises for justifiable and doubts as to the independence and impartiality of the arbitrator. So in the given circumstances, it also said that a bias will not be a conclusion as to the lack of independence or impartiality. It also said that if bias was to be considered as actual bias as we considered, then as a totally the arbitrator being impartial, then the standard set for that would be too high. So it gave a clear explanation stating that it only amounts to a justifiable apprehension of bias and not a bias as a conclusion. It also considered the various judgments, which I have mentioned in the PowerPoint. These judgments were predominantly against the government, where the government contractors, where the chief engineers were appointed as arbitrators or retired or employees were appointed as the arbitrators. And the apex court had held that such appointments were valid. The first time when the same was questioned considerably was in Indian Oil Corporation versus Raja Transport, 2009 8 SEC 520. In this case, it was held that the employee should not be the arbitrator, and thereafter, he should only be, they said that the employee who is appointed as an arbitrator shall not be directly involved in the dispute that has arisen, or the person who is in charge of the dispute should not be his higher authority, or rather the arbitrator should not be a subordinate officer to that. So to such an extent, there was a deviation by the Supreme Court and said, such a person shall not be appointed, employee arbitrator cannot be appointed. Then the judgment came in case of Denzel Proprietary and Biopharma's Bipron Trading, where in those cases, the court had held that the government cannot, the government contract cannot accept, cannot be held valid where it employs its own arbitrators, employees as arbitrator, and independent arbitrators were appointed. It was in based on these things which are going on, the Law Commission made several deliberations. And in fact, Mr. Malhotra, who was also in the advisory board, had suggested that the party's autonomy should not be given a go-by. And so there should not be any proceedings which affects the party autonomy. However, the Law Commission felt that with respect to party autonomy, it has to be respected. At the same time, by way of party autonomy, the arbitrators cannot be appointed at their whims and fancies, where the arbitrators themselves will be the judges of the proceedings, or they'll be the judge of their own case. So with this, what happened was Law Commission had given a proposal to incorporate the red and orange list in the IBA guidelines on conflict of interest in international arbitration. It is this which has now created a lot of confusion. What has happened in this method is the IBA guidelines was first and foremost not a particular any statute as it is. It is an organization or an institution, arbitration institution for that matter, which gave some guidelines. It was not also its rules, it was only a guidelines, where it said certain relationships between the arbitrator and the parties, or financial, or I'll come to that later, they all come under red list. Then there were certain other categories which are considered to be under orange list, and certain other categories were under green list. Green list is such as in social media, they are friends, then still they can proceed with as an arbitrator and party. So these were the three different list which were provided by the IBA. This also applied only for international arbitration. It was not for domestic arbitration. It was for international arbitration. Here too, in case of specific specialized arbitration, they gave some exceptions to that, saying that they can have their own panel, can have appointments based on their panel members alone. Notwithstanding all these aspects, for the first time as known to me, I have not seen any other country's law which also considers this red and orange list given. Only in India, it was sought to be brought under the 2015 amendment. Based on all these things, this 2015 amendment had come. Now, one important aspect that I need to state here is, by this red and orange list, we have now changed the proposition where the arbitrator was required to give whatever disclosure that he has to a position where he has to answer the questioner, and also if there is anything else he has to give. So it became a two-way aspect. Instead of whatever the entire burden was given on the arbitrator, now notwithstanding that the burden is still on the arbitrator, it also gives certain other points also to be complied with and furnished. Now, post amendment, what happened to, what are the amendments made with respect to independence and impartiality? That's what we will be seeing now. Amendments were made to section 12.1 and 12.5. The rest of the amendment provision in section 12 remain the same. Now, with respect to 12, as I said, stated earlier, the arbitrator was required to give all the circumstances that it had in writing, which affects his independence or impartiality. Now what happens is, it has stated specifically the existence of direct or indirect, any past or present relationship with or interest in the parties or in relation to the subject matter in dispute, whether financial, business, professional or any other kind. This any other kind, again, gives a wider opportunity where the arbitrator has to give the entire aspect of it. All these things have to be provided by the arbitrator. Now, once these are given, one more aspect was brought in under 12.1b, where the arbitrator also has to see if he can complete the arbitration proceedings within a period of 12 months. Now, for this purpose, what was brought in is Schedule 5. The Schedule 5 explanation said that it shall be a guide in determining whether the circumstances exist which give rise to justifiable doubts as to the independence or impartiality. Now, what is important here is to be seen is, it clearly says 5 only talks about a justifiable ground. It doesn't talk about any ineligibility as it is. It only brings out all the aspects which might give rise to a justifiable doubt when found that it is in existence. Explanation 2 said the disclosure has to be made in accordance with Section 6, Schedule 6. If you see Schedule 6, interestingly, it will only talk about 12.1b, and Schedule 5 also will only talk about 12.1b. which would entirely mean that the said schedule is given only for the purpose of finding out whether the arbitrator has the time to complete the arbitration within a period of 12 months. However, when we read explanation 1 along with the other provision, then we come to know that it is also a declaration to find out whether there is any circumstances which arises for justifiable doubts with respect to the independence or impartiality. Now, next is important section that has come out is section 12.5. In this section, what has happened is, for the first time, the act itself gives certain relationship which it says are totally barred. A person who is having who is in such a relationship, as mentioned in 7th schedule, will not be eligible to be appointed as an arbitrator. Here it is a complete bar. I would again reiterate, under 12.1, there is not a complete bar. It only arises for a justifiable doubts. And whereas in 12.5, there is a complete bar. The only exception would be, in case the parties to an arbitration, after the dispute has arisen, have after that come to an understanding and express them in writing that they want to continue with the same arbitrator, that alone would be permitted. This was mentioned so specifically considering the arbitrations which are prevalent between the family members, where one of the family member would be very close to them, would be related, would otherwise be within the capacity of seventh schedule, would do justice for the parties because they are closely knit with and they would respect that person. So in order to avoid such a type of appointment, they give this exception. Now, what is new in section 12? So under section 12, now we see that the existence has to be given in writing by the arbitrator. It talks about the relationship, the interest with the parties, and two, the relationship with the subject matter. And what type of relationship it should be? It should be either financial, business, or professional. And as I said, other kind is generic, so they cover entire thing, which if any of these things have been omitted also, that has to come under that. Next is the disclosure with respect to his ability to devolve time is also to be mentioned, that we had seen earlier. So schedule 5 will be a guide in determining the existence of justifiable doubts, and form mentioned in schedule 6 will be have to be provided in that form. Now with 12.5 we saw the ineligibility of the arbitrator. So we'll go to the next slide. The procedure for challenge. Again, here we have to see that section 13 was not amended at all. It remained the same. So which comes to which brings us to light that any circumstances which arises with bringing on the justifiable doubts as to the independence or impartiality, they will have to be addressed under section 13 and not under any other provision. Now we have to see that whatever has been mentioned under schedule 5 and whatever the justification has been given or the circumstances mentioned has been given, if it does not fall under schedule 7, then those will be challenged only under section 13 and not in any other provision. For that matter, if the section had been left as it is and read as it is, even those the ineligibility mentioned under Schedule 7 would also come under Section 13 alone. However, HRD Construction Corporation case has made a deviation. His Lordship Justice Rohinton had mentioned that the arbitrator becomes ineligible, and so in such cases it need not go before under 13. It is straight away they can come for a change of mandate under 14. In all other circumstances, the challenge to the appointment of arbitrator has to be made only under section 13. In fact, in yesterday's meeting, Justice Kaul had answered a question with respect to where it has to be raised. He had also said that it has to be raised only under section 13. And interestingly, he is also a party to the judgment in HRD Corporation, which laid down that you have to raise it in case of section schedule 7 grounds. It has to be under section 14. Now, with respect to 14, it talks about change of mandate. I would also say that 14.1 is also in another manner very much apt and applicable, for the reason under schedules 2, schedule 7, the arbitrator becomes ineligible, which is also mentioned in 12.5 of the Act. That being so, the arbitrator de jure becomes incapable of being an arbitrator, and he loses his mandate automatically. In such provision also, 14.1 can be considered as the right approach. However, Section 13, as it is, doesn't mention. And today we have the HRD corporation, which entitles them for 14. And again, I would repeat, at risk of repetition, I'm saying it is only in case of ineligibility arising out of Schedule 7. This is what I reiterated this thing. Jurisdiction of 14, only in case where the arbitrator was appointed by the court. This I have stated so because when there is a change in mandate, you will have to appoint in the same manner as the arbitrator was earlier appointed. If it has been appointed by the court, then it has to go to the court. And under Section 13, if he recuses, only then it will come to 14. Now, what is this fifth schedule? Fifth schedule is available on the Act, and I think going by each and every item would be a time-consuming factor. So, for the purpose of understanding, I would take you all to the basic aspects of the fifth schedule. Now, when one considers the fifth schedule, interestingly, will have all the red list and the orange list, both combined together. The purpose why it has been given is a disclosure statement under 6 would require that, Schedule 6 would require that all the disclosures have to be given as per Schedule 5. So it has enumerated entire events as per in Schedule 5, which has to be complied with in section Schedule 6. Now, what are the aspects that have been mentioned in Schedule 5? First, it contains with respect to relationship with parties and counsel. These are items 1 to 14. Relationship between the arbitrator to the dispute, how he is interested in the dispute. This is item 15 and 16. Arbitrator direct or indirect interest in the dispute. This comes under 17 to 19. So these are all under red list. So any person which will be in exact verbatim repeated in Schedule 7 also. Now, with respect to the rest of it, which is in the orange list, the fifth schedule, which is in the orange list, are previous services of one of the parties or other involvement in the case, items 20 to 24. Relationship between an arbitrator and another arbitrator or counsel, item 25 to 29. Relationship between the arbitrator and the party, others involved in the arbitration, item 30 to 31. Other circumstances 32 to 34. We see that these items are all under orange list and they only give rise to a justifiable doubt and not a doubt as it is. Now, as I said, in seventh schedule deals with the ineligibility and it works on the three aspects: relationship between the parties and the counsel, relationship between the arbitrator to the dispute, and direct or indirect interest in the dispute. Now, after this amendment had come in, there have been certain apex court judgments which have considerably changed the entire scenario of the party autonomy, the way appointment of arbitrators have to be done, and it has also given way for a lot of misuse also. The first case which is worth mentioning is the DMRC case, which is 2017-4-SEC-665, penned by Justice Sikri, where the arbitrator, in this case, what happened was the Delhi Metro Rail Corporation was to appoint the arbitrator from its panel. Now, there are 5 talks about certain restrictions with respect to panel. So it was taken up saying that they cannot appoint from their panel and only 5 from the selected list of its panel were provided to the respondent or the petitioner appellant in that case for the purpose of being selected as an arbitrator. Out of 5, 3 were required to be selected. The court, after hearing it, came to the conclusion that they can have their panel as their own. And one aspect is they said that you don't give them a choice of 5 from the 5. You give the entire list of your panel arbitrators and let the petitioner there and select from the select three arbitrators from them. This was well accepted, where we see that panel of arbitrators can be maintained has been established. What the court would request is to be more transparent in appointing from the panel or giving a choice to the respondent. Of course, this is not found in the act. This is again a judicial interpretation. Next comes the important case, very important case, TRF 2017-8 SEC 377. This was penned by Justice Deepak Mishra, the Chief Justice as he then was, where it was held in the arbitration clause therein was that unless otherwise provided, any dispute or difference between the parties in connection with this agreement shall be referred to a sole arbitrator of the managing director of the buyer or his nominee. Now, what has to be considered here is the managing director himself was considered to be a sole arbitrator of the buyer or his nominee. So they gave, the court went into the interpretation saying that the managing director can be the arbitrator or his nominee alone can be the arbitrator. So the arbitrator here would be the person in charge of the entire proceedings. He would be a party himself. He is the beneficiary of the arbitral proceedings. He will be the ultimate person who is going to pass the award also. So he will be a judge of his own case, and which is clearly attracted by the fifth schedule or the seventh schedule, and hence he cannot, he'll be ineligible to be appointed. And he, it also further went on to say that since the managing director is ineligible, he also cannot nominate an arbitrator. So this, for the first time, a principle has devolved such that not only the from the ineligibility of the arbitrator, the shift has been made to the ineligibility of the appointing authority. Now one has to consider here that Section 11 provides that any person can be appointed as an arbitrator, and it also says that a person, the procedure for appointing an arbitrator can be agreed upon by the parties. Now, one restriction which was brought in by the Schedule Amendment Act is, which is under Section Schedule 7, is direct relationship. They made a condition that these people cannot be won't be eligible. Nowhere it was brought in that the appointing authority will become ineligible. Now, here is the case. First, for the first time in a mild manner, they said that since the managing director became ineligible, he also loses his power to appoint an arbitrator. So it is comes under the ineligibility aspect, and so the appointment cannot be made by the managing director. Now, HRD construction came in subsequently. It is 2018-12 SEC 471. It was penned by Justice Rohinton. The aspect of the justifiable doubts and the ineligibility was brought in. Their lordships went on to say that Section 12.5 portion of it deals with, which are coming under 7, will deal only with a total ineligibility, and with respect to the others, they only talk about a justifiable doubts as to its existence. Friends, I've been repeatedly saying that justifiable doubts as to its existence, because what is happening now is anything and everything which comes under the orange list is also tried to be brought in under section, under Schedule 7, saying that it is all mentioned in one schedule, that is 5. So they all are merged together, and hence it has to be considered. It is not so. The certain items mentioned in Schedule 7 will have a separate ineligibility. The others are only with respect to justifiable doubts. And it also stated that in case of ineligibility, the members, parties need not go in for Section 13. They can approach the court for under 14.1 for change of mandate. and they reserved their opinion with respect to Schedule 5. However, they said that Schedule 1 to item 1 to 19 of the Schedule 5th Schedule are identical and to 7, and they are only for the purpose of disclosure, and thus that should not be merged with the other provisions. Now, based on this, the first misuse that we can say is in Bharat Broadband Network, which came up for before the court in 2019 and reported in 2019 5 SEC 755. In this case, interestingly, Bharat Broadband was the appointing authority, and it had appointed one of its employee, and the respondent also had United Telecoms had also filed its statement. Nowhere it had objected for the appointment of the arbitrator. It was not challenged. However, after TRF judgment, the Bharat Broadband came into a position of challenging the arbitrator appointed by it, saying that he is an employee and he cannot be an arbitrator, and such an appointment is invalid. So it has to be not considered, and the validity of that appointment has to be nullified. Now, this was interestingly opposed by the respondent, saying that it has given a consent in the form of filing an objection to the main merits of the case, and it did not choose to object to the appointment of the arbitrator, and the same would amount to a waiver. Now, while deciding the case, the courts held that the waiver has to be specific in the form of writing, and it cannot be just by filing of a pleading. It cannot be said that they have waived, and the court had gone to the extent of saying that the appointment was in fact not valid, and they had changed the nullified the appointment and asked for a fresh appointment. The final judgment that I would be placing today is Parkinson's. This has created much confusion, rather added more fuel to TRF. This was decided by Justice U. Lalit and Indu Malhotra in 2019, SEC Online SE 1517. In this case, the dispute resolution clause was about disputes or differences shall be referred to for adjudication through arbitration by a sole arbitrator appointed by the chairman and managing director of HSCC within 30 days. Now, here the court held that the chairman and managing director is a person who is interested in the outcome of the award, as he is the person who is given the authority to appoint. It relied on TRF and said the chairman and managing director cannot be appointed as an arbitrator, and so the analogy goes along with it, saying that a person who cannot do an act by himself cannot also entrust it to another person to do it. Based on that, it had said that since the managing director was ineligible ineligible for being an arbitrator, he can also not be in a position to appoint an arbitrator. In other words, it said a person who is interested in the outcome of the award cannot be the appointing person. This, my friends, would totally tarnish the party autonomy in appointment of arbitrator, and this has to be brought in again. And as spoken by Justice Kaul yesterday, and also by Shaktar, they were also at the view that this has to be reconsidered, and it will be considered in the short view. So with this, I conclude my submissions, whatever I had in my mind. Any doubts or any questions that you have, you may raise.
Shivashanmugam, you can take some questions if anything is posted in the chat box, or you can
One second.
All the people so that if they are ready, they can cover.
One question I have from one Mr. Anand is, can the independence and impartiality be a subject matter of a challenge under Section 34 on an expert's award?
On an
expert's award. The arbitrator being an expert in the field.
Yes, they want to challenge it, they can always challenge, but how successful they are going to be will be a question, because the important aspect here is how far bias is going to be established is question set. If they are able to establish bias, though it is an expert, he may be the arbitrator, may be an expert in that field. But then if the arbitrator it is established that the arbitrator was biased, then definitely, and the court finds that it is biased and it affects its conscience, definitely it can interfere.
In fact, Anand has now made a correction to his question. He said whether it is an ex parte award.
Ex parte award? No, ex parte award is going to be very difficult, because where are they going to prove that he was biased or he lacked independence or impartiality? In an ex parte award, generally, it is only with respect to principles of natural justice that they will challenge, and courts sometimes entertain it, sometimes not, based on the records it is.
Okay, then I have another question from one Mr. Nitin Singh Bhati. If objections regarding appointment of arbitrator is not decided by the arbitrator, what should be the position?
No, in HRD also it has been mentioned that when an objection has been raised, it has to be first adhered to. The arbitrator cannot postpone it to the end of the passing award. That itself would show that he is biased. And then if he passes an award, that would be a good case for him to take it under 34.
Then I have another question from Mr. Anand Selvam. What about the limitation if expires during the corona period due to the condoned power of court restricted by the statute? Maybe I will rephrase it in this manner like this. See, the Arbitration Act is 90 plus 30 days.
30 days.
So what will happen to those period which are now during this lockdown period? What will happen to those limitation periods?
We have already
automatically extended or not?
Yes, Supreme Court has also held that all the limitation period will be extended, and that would also squarely apply to this matter, because wherever there are strict dates fixed also, the court said that it will be extended. We have seen that judgment in the recent in Supreme Court also. Om sir has got some
some clarification. One is that you clearly brought out two issues. One is impartiality and ineligibility. So in terms of the provisions of the enactment post amendment in 2015, as well as the schedules, you make it very clear that if there is a case for ineligibility, he cannot continue. You can go to court and ask for a change of mandate.
Yes.
And in cases of impartiality, that is made out in terms of what the schedules are provided, and in terms of which, if you have a case for a bias or some other case, then you challenge it as part of your 34 challenge is what you brought up. My clarification is that as regarding this schedule 5 or 6 or 7, on the procedural aspects, how does this come on record? Now, that says that there is a schedule, there are points you also point out very clearly as to serial number 1 to 19, there is one.
Yes.
How does procedurally it come out on record? Can you just clarify and explain?
Yes. Schedule 6 actually gives a form, it is in a format manner, it is a form as it is, which covers the entire aspect of schedule 5. What are all mentioned in schedule 5, how it has to be mentioned, it has been mentioned, given there. So only thing is we need to prepare the fill up the form, and as an arbitrator, it has to be sent immediately on his appointment to the parties as the first option.
So that schedule 6 comes on record immediately. Yes. On the appointment, at the first instance, arbitrator has to disclose
exactly
by signing a schedule 6.
Exactly, exactly.
Will it be sent to the parties also?
Or it has to be sent to the parties. That will be the first communication that you will be making to the party.
So based on which the party...
Yeah, I think you muted. Sir, you muted.
So based on that disclosure in Form 6, which the parties receive,
yes,
they will decide as to the...
Exactly, whether they want to challenge it or if they find something is incorrect, they can challenge it.
Thank you.
Ashok, I have a question. This is Anbargan.
Yes, sir.
See, actually, suppose if sixth schedule, if the notice is declaration is given by the arbitrator, later if he becomes impartial towards one, or if he is taking a bias, then what is the position of that?
So I will frame your question in two parts. One is the circumstances arose which later on becomes comes to this position that he will come under one of the justifiable grounds. In that case, what happens is as soon as he comes to such a position, he has to come forward and give his disclosure. So the situation may arise, certain situation may arise even subsequently. When it comes out subsequently, he has to make that disclosure. That is one aspect. The second aspect is, if the party finds, even after the disclosure is made, that there are certain circumstances that has arisen which shows that he is impartial, from the date of that knowledge, they have to file an application that he is partial or not independent, and that application has to be made within 15 days from their knowledge.
That is under section 13, is it?
13.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, fine.
Ashok, there are two other couple of things.
Yes.
One, Mr. Chelli Muthu has asked, is the Supreme Court verdict extending the limitation during the lockdown reported?
I think it was not reported. It had come out in
circulated.
Even Asiva, you also had it, right?
I think it circulated in almost all the social media.
Yes.
That decision is there in the Supreme Court website. It is in a suo motu writ petition. We can share it in the group also. It is a decision which is available in the Supreme Court website.
It is also available in Bar and Bench app that is available with the latest judgments. It is available in that also.
Okay.
Okay, then another Saravanan Dandapani has asked on another thing. Yesterday's judgment by Supreme Court that non-participation in arbitration proceedings result in waiver of rights to raise objections after the award. In a particular case, appointment hit by Parkinson's case, but service was completed. Respondent has not appeared. Whether award could be challenged on the ground of ineligibility?
See, ineligibility is a de jure aspect. It is the arbitrator becomes de jure incapable. Though he might, the respondent might not have appeared at that point of time and raised this question, there is no question of waiver. The waiver cannot come in. In fact, it has been very clearly stated in Bharat Broadband by Justice Rohinton. They're saying that the waiver has to be in explicit in writing. So, a violation under 7th schedule shall be only in case, exception, only exception would be only in case of in writing, that too which has taken after the, written after the dispute has commenced. So, in any other waiver would not, in my opinion, affect the raising of that point of ineligibility.
Okay, one second, I'll unmute Satish. Satish has got some question. Satish.
Good evening, brother.
Very good evening, Satish.
Thank you, brother. Thank you, brother, for your enlightening lecture. You have virtually refreshed all our memories during this lockdown period on an important aspect. And my question is, see, this is regarding the dictum of the Supreme Court. Just now we referred to in this Bharat Broadband Network.
Okay.
So, what I have understood is that mere filing of the pleadings, that is a claim statement or defense, would not debar a party from challenging the impartiality. I think I have rightly understood.
No, it has to be gone into in deep, because 4 is also there. 4, which says that if a procedure has to be taken up at a particular point of time and it is not taken up, it amounts to waiver. But what happens in Bharat Band is, with respect to the ineligibility mentioned in Section 7, Schedule 7.
That's what I'm asking.
Only in case of Schedule 7, I think, that waiver doesn't come into picture.
No, normally what happens is, to say, like in Port Trust case or NLC or in Railways, as we all know, normally they appoint their own subordinates.
Yes.
The notice comes to the litigant. Litigant, before contacting us, he informally writes some letter saying, kindly give some time, I have to contact my lawyer. Something like that he writes. Then he comes to us. And instances are not few where some junior counsel, they file their claim statement. In such a situation, just I'm thinking loud about the respondent. See, how long the respondent can should be kept under the threat. That claimant may at one point of time turn around and say, notwithstanding, I have filed my claim statement. Now I am supported by the verdict of the Supreme Court, by and in which I can still question your impartiality.
Yes, that is what? Exactly broadband. Broadband case is exactly that.
Then the threat will be always hanging in the above the head of the respondent.
Yes, that is exactly what happens in case of ineligibility. We'll have to understand it in this concept, that there is an ineligibility. A person who is not qualified or who is not entitled to be an arbitrator is sitting there as an arbitrator. Then in such case, whatever he does is a void one. So ultimately, that can be raised at any point of time. That is the jurisprudence under which Bharat Broadband had come in.
So that ineligibility concept, the aspect can be questioned till that last moment, that is even day
exactly,
before the last
exactly, happened. Exactly. When it comes to ineligibility, it can be questioned. There's no question of waiver excepting when it is in writing after the dispute.
Then it will be preferable for that such of those arbitrators to get a consent from both parties, is it not?
Definitely. They have to get a consent after the dispute has started.
Okay. Thank you. Very kind of you. Thank you.
Ashok sir, good evening. This is Ilamovan Advocate.
Good evening, sir.
Sir, this is a wonderful presentation.
Thank you. Thank you.
In a simple language, you made us to understand what is Section 12, 13 and 14, and as well as Schedule 5, 6 and 7. My question will be, whether what is the stages? Whether I can raise the independence and impartiality of the arbitrator, even after submission of written arguments and matter is posted for RS, if I come to know something about this integrity, then I can raise as a question even after that. Is there any
Section 3, the provision would say that you can raise it, you have to raise
15 days.
Within 15 days. And yes. It also says within 15 days from the date of you coming to know about this in the lack of independence or impartiality.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So you will have to establish that you came to know about it only at that point of time.
It is only that is required.
Yes. Yes.
That
yes.
cannot be in a pre-trial, post-trial. Written
nothing like that. Nothing like that. Has to be knowledge has to be established.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So, any further?
As such, there is no questions.
Okay.
Then Om, you can take over.
There are many messages which actually. Congratulate the presenter of the session, Mr. Ashok Pathy. Many have said it is a very good session. And
thank you.
On a very small topic, you have given us a very good enlightened thought for the day. So with this, we will end today's session. We are looking forward to more of such sessions in future. As a next immediate session, we are having a program tomorrow evening again. There will be a session on inquiries and orders relating to interlocutory applications. So we hope that it will be more an enlightening session, more to the subordinate practitioners at the subordinate bar and also before the civil courts. So that will be presented by Dr. N.V. Badarinath, the presiding officer of DRT 1 Chennai. So he will be with us tomorrow evening. I request all the members to join tomorrow evening. The required link will be shared by Mr. Shiv Shanmugam. And the topic for tomorrow's session would be inquiries and orders relating to interlocutory applications. He will be touching upon interim injunctions, mandatory injunctions, appointment of commissions, appointment of receivers, and so forth, whatever it is. So please join us tomorrow. Thank you for the day. Thank you very much.